So this is a really great event. Welcome you all. I'm pinch hitting a little bit for Sam Raskov, who had to be out of town, who helped organize this event. So we're thrilled to have all of you here while you're sitting. And of course, we're equally thrilled to have Noah back. Welcome back to the law school, Noah. We've missed you, I guess. But I, reading in Moshe's book, I learned about the unity of all things. So maybe you've never been gone in some way.
Exactly.
What's going to happen is we're going to...
Just a second.
What's going to happen now is that Noah's going to talk a little bit, and then they're going to have a conversation for about 45 minutes. Welcome to the dean. And then there'll be a Q&A, and at 6 we're going to have drinks and a toast to Moshe for his wonderful accomplishment. So, Noah.
Thank you, Steve. It's a huge pleasure and an honor to be here in connection with Moshe's extraordinary book, and it's also just a huge pleasure to be at home. This feels like home to me, and so thank you very much for asking me to be here for it. We have a terrific turnout, and one of the features of having such a great turnout is that we have a mix of people in the room who are themselves specialists on Maimonides and on medieval Jewish thought. And we also have people who are interested in the topic, but perhaps haven't spent, say, 25 odd years of their lives working on it. So the challenge for us will be to talk about the issues that Moshe's book raises in a way that's of interest to the former without being incomprehensible to the latter. So that will be our goal. And in order to facilitate that, let me just begin by saying a couple of quick things to contextualize the book and its subject, mostly to spare Moshe the embarrassment of having to say them. So let me start with the topic. Moshe has written many wonderful books, but in the last several thick major books that he's written in Hebrew, he's been working his way through the most important intellectual figures of the medieval Jewish intellectual tradition. So he wrote a rich and fascinating book on a man called Menachem Ha'Meiri. If you haven't heard of him, don't worry about it. Another on Nachmanides, about whom the most important thing you ought to know for these purposes is that he's not the same person as Maimonides, but is also hugely important. But in this book, Moshe is taking on the person who is the towering central figure of the medieval Jewish intellectual tradition. And just to give you some sense of what that means, this is a tradition which has at its core analytical, conceptual, legal analysis, and Moses Maimonides is by far the most important practitioner of that, and Moshe argues actually the originator of it in an important way. There's another important strand, which is the Jewish philosophical tradition. Well, in that area too, Moses Maimonides is again by far the most significant central figure in the history of the tradition. Now, there is also a mystical tradition, and there, as Moshe points out in the book, although Maimonides himself was not deeply inclined in this direction, as interpreted by many subsequent receivers of his work, he was also a towering figure, although in this case it's by a kind of misapprehension, or maybe a kind of willful misapprehension. So this is big game, and I was talking to Kathy before, and I was saying that if you're only going to come to one event on medieval Jewish history and intellectual thought, this is the one to come to, because this is the central figure. Then there's the ambition of Moshe's book, which is which matches the importance of the figure. We have good, even excellent studies of individual works by Moses Maimonides, including, for example, of his magisterial code of Jewish law, and of his philosophical work, The Guide for the Perplexed. We have some interesting biographical work, excellent biographical work in some cases, that works on the details of the life of Moses Maimonides and contextualizes him as a Mediterranean intellectual. But almost no one has attempted, and I think it's certainly the case that before Moshe no one has succeeded, to produce a work that tries comprehensively and succeeds to depict the human being, the legal accomplishment, the philosophical accomplishment, and the relationship between them. And that is just an extraordinary accomplishment. And if you had said before I read this book to me, it can be done in 483 pages, I would have said, no, it can't. Can't be done. And I would have been wrong, because Moshe has in fact done it. And he's done it by going quite deeply into particularized texts so that the reader gets a feeling, a representative feeling, of what Moses Maimonides is doing. So when Moshe, for example, addresses the structure of the code of Jewish law that is the Mishneh Torah, which is completely original. No one had ever produced before Maimonides, as Moshe points out, a comprehensive, conceptually organized code that covered the entire body of Jewish law. Either they followed the order of the Talmud, which is essentially an associative order, associative in the sort of the way that you would free associate on the analyst couch, very rich and interesting, but associative, or they had followed a systematic order of trying to list 613 commandments and go through them one by one. Maimonides rejects both of these approaches and gives a conceptual account. So what most people would do is just say that, but it's not clear what I mean by saying that. What Moshe does is he then gives you concrete examples and will give you 10, 20 pages analyzing the particularities so that the person who reads the book has the experience of doing Maimonidean studies. And to do that and make it representative is, I think, the genius of the book. I think it's that at every page, one is not just having it described, one is brought into and experiences the practice of how Moshe does it. And he does the same in the philosophical parts of the book as well. I just want to give one, not an example, because I'm not going to work through the example, but I think we could talk about some examples, but mention one particularly interesting feature of what Moshe has done here, and then I'll start the conversation. And that is, although this is certainly a biography that is in important ways a historical biography, and it's interested in historical context, and it's interested in the secondary literature, it's not the kind of book that would be written by someone who primarily identified as a historian, I think, precisely because Moshe is actually inherently interested in the conceptual issues that he goes into, which, as again, are legal and legal conceptual and philosophical. So when, for example, Moshe is discussing the question of what sort of book was this comprehensive code of Jewish law, was it in fact meant to be, as Maimonides sometimes made it sound like it was, a replacement for all other legal work ever produced by a Jewish writer in the previous 700 years? And by the way, he does say that in the introduction. Not this Moshe, but the other Moshe says it in the introduction. Or was it a compendium of all of the work that had been done by those people over that period of time? Now, anyone who is a historian would have, as Moshe does in the book, go through the sources and show you that in some situations Maimonides says one thing. When he's writing to, unsurprisingly, to other rabbis, he says, oh, no, I wasn't actually saying you don't have to learn everything else. I was just making the point that you could skip everything else. When he's talking to his philosophical initiate students, he says, don't bother studying the other stuff. So that's an important observation for a historian, but Moshe takes it yet a step further and gives his own original conceptual analysis of two different ways to conceptualize the whole project, one of which he describes as fundamentally constitutive, where the book is constitutive of the tradition, and the other in which the book is a summary or an account of the existence of the tradition. That's the kind of distinction that Maimonides himself liked to do, and which many of Maimonides' most influential interpreters have done, and Moshe does it in this book, and that moves the book beyond even being excellent history and into the sphere of being its own legal, conceptual, and philosophical analysis. So I urge you to read the book. And even for those of you who don't primarily read these books, I just want to report anecdotally that I had the book in my house as I was reading it, and my mother and father were visiting for the weekend, and my mother, who is a political scientist who does not generally read medieval Jewish anything, picked it up and was reading it so intensely that I had to literally take it away from her because I had to finish reading it in order to prepare for today. And that was a remarkable experience and for me to observe, and it's a kind of indication that this is a book that should be very widely read. It's got lots in it for experts, but lots in it for everybody who's simply interested in the topic. So that's sort of contextualization, and now we can turn to some conversation about it. And so let me start by asking Moshe the rather obvious question that an author of a book is always asked, but which in this case has, I think, greater importance, which is, what made you decide to take on Maimonides at this point?
Well, this, first of all, thanks, and thanks for the wonderful presentation of the book, and thanks for coming. It has been, the writing of the book didn't take that long, but the studying of the men is years, and since I've been a child, basically, I've been studying Maimonides. There was a search for understanding, I would say, the Maimonidean project. Because there are many great Jewish Talmudic or philosophical scholars in the medieval period. But I don't think any of them was as ambitious. Maimonides had a temperament of not only a religious reformer, but a religious founder. If he didn't have Judaism to interpret, he would have invented. he's, in that respect, closer in mentality. These are very rare people, like Luther, like... it's a kind of a... And I wanted to represent the project. In what way Judaism entered his mind and came out completely differently than it entered. And try to present it in its totality. Because there's so many segments, etc. The other thing is that I actually, and you're right, it's my entry into the biographical questions is late. But I realized that I don't think there is any medieval Jew that we know so much about. Mm-hmm. Like Maimonides, because of the Gniza, the Cairo Gniza, and because his letters were treated without the usual in the usual way in which copies treat the responsa of other authorities, shedding all personal stuff. It was canonized. So I while reading again the letters, the fragments, the thing, I understood that there is an opportunity here also to go very deep into his personal making without far-fetched speculative work. So that was what drove me really to articulate the project, the very ambitious project.
I want to pick up on what you said about how if this material hadn't been there, Maimonides would have had to invent it.
Right.
You make the point in discussing Maimonides' rational philosophical speculation, right, his focus especially on the Aristotelian tradition,
right,
that Maimonides tells us that this was the secret tradition,
right,
of ancient Judaism. Essentially, this is oversimplification, but essentially Aristotelianism was actually the secret tradition of Judaism. But that he hasn't learned from his teachers,
right,
that this is the case. He's come up with it on his own.
Right.
What do you make of that kind of a claim? I mean, do you see it as an act of invention, wholly? Do you connect it to the way other philosophers were doing something similar in the Muslim world at the time?
Yeah, well, clearly his world, his philosophical world, was the world of Al-Farabi and other Muslim philosophers. But it's one thing that interesting about him, right? So he, among other things, as you mentioned, he wants to codify all of Jewish law. And at the end, the ambition is not only to make a good book that is a representation of the law, but it's actually the law itself. And then you ask yourself, what is the source of the authority of the project, right? So he doesn't lean on any institutional authority. He doesn't have an institutional place. There is no revelation or claim of revelation. And in that respect, both in philosophy and law, he relies on his power, just the sheer power of his intellect. And that's, he says at one point at the beginning of the third part of the guide, where he begins to unfold the secrets of Torah, right? And he says, I'm not entitled to write them, because traditionally you're not allowed to write the esoteric stuff. But because they were so kept, they disappeared. And I kind of restored them independently through my reasoning. And when I go, it will go with me. I mean, I don't think anybody has made such an ambitious claim. Therefore, I break the prohibitions of secrecy for your sake, because when I'm gone, it's gone with me. So there is this kind of rare, again, this mentality of founders, rare self-confidence in the power of reasoning to get the thing right.
But you mentioned Luther as someone else who has this kind of degree of confidence.
Right.
And it's certainly a good analysis or analogy, but Luther is also very angry about something.
Right.
And we know what he's angry about, and he has good reason to be angry
right.
about it. What's your sense of the motivation that's behind this? I mean, it's one thing to say, as you do, clearly
right.
the confidence is epic.
Right.
But what's the deeper
motivation? Well, I think he wanted to transform the tradition in three dimensions, three very important dimensions, religiously speaking. The first one is redefining the problem of idolatry, right? So the way the tradition defines the problem of idolatry, there are those images outside, right? There is an iconoclastic fervor against those images. And he transformed this whole concept by claiming that the main problem of idolatry is the mental image, right? So you sit in the synagogue next to Maimonides, and you have an anthropomorphic image of God in your head, whom you refer to. And for my
he's the old man with the beard.
Yes, the old man with the beard, whatever.
You think he's Steve?
And
tall, imposing,
exactly.
beard.
That's God in its best.
There you go.
Mode. that person is actually worse than a worship of idols, right? So
yes.
the problem has become internalized to the mind and to the community. Now, this feature of transformation has immense implications because usually the way the problem of idolatry was presented is Jews, Muslims, to a certain degree some trends in Christianity, are not allowed to make pictorial or three-dimensional presentations of God. But language is completely free. You can talk about God's hand, God's face, etc., but you don't dare paint it.
And also now, the Bible talks about the hands.
Yes, Bible, the Midrash. Now, when you say that the problem is the internal image, then you have a problem with the religious language of the tradition, right? Because the thing that nourishes the internal image is language. And what you have is a radical religious philosophical understanding that the language of tradition has to be overcome because it nourishes the worst thing, which is idolatry. And that's the first part of the Guide of the Perplexed, really a strong critique of religious language or the possibility of religious language. That was the first thing. Now you can imagine the zeal and also the way in which this idea was resented by so much of Maimonidean environment. That's the first thing. The second thing, I think, no less important, is it breaks with a certain very common religious understanding of the medium of revelation. What happened many times is, traditionally, people will say, look, there is a natural inertia, right? Causal structure. And revelation, the divine revelation, is in breaking the causal structure through miracle, right? That's a very common conception. What Maimonides does is that he wants to marginalize this idea completely and say that the main medium of revelation is the causal structure itself, nature, what he would call wisdom rather than will. Now, if you go this direction, you have to reread half of Judaism. What about miracles, providence, reward and punishment? Revelation itself, by the way, the giving of God's word is himself a break of will into history. So the other aspect of the guide is rereading, reinterpreting Jewish structure as a whole. Here again, you say the motivation comes from a certain understanding that the Jewish reality as it is doesn't reflect what he thought was the proper religious attitude, both in terms of the concept of idolatry and the concept of God's revelation. Now, the third thing, which is in some ways the most lethal, he breaks completely the distinction, a common distinction, what's within the tradition and what's outside of it, right? Or what we will call Torah and wisdom. And he begins with the following assumption. And this is why I actually try to write a book without mentioning the word rationalism. Because he's rationalist, etc., and you have done the work. For him, the role of reason and the integration of reason into his system was so intimate that basically he thought that through reason a person reaches the most highest form of religious devotion, which is, if I would say a few words about that, it's a transformation from fear to love. He has a statement in the Mishneh Torah and then repeats it in the guide, Lefia de'ava, according to knowledge, love. This is a powerful statement. And he means by that the following thing. Fear is a relationship, as instrumental relationship. You worship God or other people because you're afraid of their punishing power or you want their reward because they can bestow upon you reward. And you are in a grip of what I would call fear and desire. The function of knowledge or science or philosophy is to free you from instrumental relationship to the world. Because what science does, what knowledge does, knowledge teaches you to see the thing not in relationship to you, and also to marginalize your place in the universe in totality. Only when you go through knowledge, through the medium of knowledge, you can genuinely love the world and God, which means you can relate to it in non-instrumental fashion, which is from Maimonides will be then the ultimate way of living a full human life, right? Transcending the grip of desire and fear. So what you have here is the third, what I will call the third principle of transformation, which is really to break a very common distinction of what's in the tradition and what's outside of it, right? Now, if you take each of these three things, they could have nourished a whole career of a person. He tried to do them all together. There were internal connections between them. And if you want to do that, which he thought that's his mission, you really have to engage in a radical reinterpretation of the tradition in its totality.
Now, one distinctive feature of this undertaking is that in his first two important works, the commentary on the Mishnah and then in the Code, he doesn't talk very much philosophy. I mean, there are some places in the commentary on the Mishnah, but in the Code, it's pretty buried in the interstices. And it's only much later in his life that he gets to writing the kind of summum of the philosophical work. So I thought maybe, especially because we are, in fact, in a law school, it would be interesting to take one example that you write about in the book of a concrete legal issue and talk about how he addresses it. And I thought maybe a useful one would be the case of the Isha Katlanit. This is the Talmudic principle that when a woman has been married to two husbands, each of whom has died, she ought not be permitted to remarry. And then the question of why that should be the case is precisely of the issue. So do you want to say a word about the case? It's a fascinating instance of it connects many of the themes that you've been talking about.
One concern of mine was from the perspective of understanding his legal work is to ask myself in what way his philosophical convictions impact his legal rulings. Is there a connection? How far and in what way? So this will be a good example. I mean, Maimonides, there are lots of rulings in the Talmud, not lots, but quite a few of them, that are based on what Maimonides will believe superstitious, metaphysical.
As this was a good example.
Yeah. So basically, she's considered Isha Katlanit, a lethal woman, whom you don't want to. She's becoming a kind of an environmental hazard, you know. So now Maimonides understood, and Maimonides says, this is really a psychosomatic problem. If she might be a danger, it's because you believe it's a danger here.
He says, and only that to a person of a weak constitution.
Right, weak constitution, exactly. And he says himself in one of his responsa that he completely disregarded the prohibition. And that because here comes, when you are free of that idea, right, then you have his own sensitivity to the fate of this widow who's not allowed to remarry, being isolated as a dangerous being. And you can see how he gives credence to the Talmudic prohibition, relying on this psychosomatic phenomenon for weak constitution. And at the moment he begins to tell you that there is no problem, he will free you from that, therefore disentangle the whole legal problem. So this is one very interesting case that that he does. By the way, if you talk about fervor, you know, Maimonides, part of the real achievement of the Mishneh Torah, good legal work is also a literary achievement, right? We all know that. You know, when you read a good legal opinion, it's not only smart, it's also written well. Now, Maimonides' Hebrew in the Mishneh Torah is one of the greatest achievements of the Hebrew language as a whole. It's like of a cholesterol-free Hebrew. Now,
I don't know if the words great achievement and cholesterol-free should go in the same sentence, but I do agree with you that it's a very great accomplishment.
By the way, you have the 16th century code, the Shulchan Aruch, who's another very important written by Yosef Karo, and here and there he does copy-paste from the Mishneh Torah, who's a 12th century book. And you immediately, even without knowing, you immediately realize this is a different linguistic touch. Now, so the book is very restrained, beautifully restrained, but there are few moments where Maimonides becomes excessive, you know, against, you know, his tendency as a writer. And it's always related to the following thing, where the hyperboles of, you know, of his language. It's always related when he understands that religious articles, like a mezuzah or other, like a book of prayers, religious objects, are being used instrumentally to protect you, as if they're protections of the body, rather than to relieve you of those fears.
As if they were amulets.
As if they were amulets. There he becomes furious. If you want to see Maimonidean fury, that's where you'll meet it, right? So, for example, he has a moment where, this is, by the way, relevant to all of us who teach. Maimonides thought that you're not allowed to get financial compensation for either study Torah or teach it, because he thought that this will instrumentalize the value of study. Now, clearly, this is not an accepted norm.
I don't know.
And it wasn't accepted among many scholars. By the way, Maimonides practiced medicine. Didn't take a penny for teaching or for studying. In his previous life, before the death of his brother, there was a family business of trade. And there you see the fury of Maimonides appearing, right? He says, the one who studies Torah and takes reward for it, Dvar Hashem Bizai, he has desecrated God's word. Kibama Oradat, he has
extinguished
the light of knowledge. You see the Maimonidean fury emerging in these spots. By the way, it's funny because in where I live in Jerusalem, I go to the grocery store next to us. There's a pious or slightly pious person, and he has different.
Wealth of sociological analysis.
He has different pictures of great rabbis. They do good for the business, right? Now, one of them is the kind of assumed picture of Maimonides, right? You know, there is this kind of you see it in his sculpture in Cordova.
There's a pictorial tradition of representing Maimonides.
Yeah. There's nothing to do with him, but it became conventionally a representation of Maimonides. And I come to the store, I always kind of has a second thought. Maimonides will turn in his grave to see how this the one who combated all those dimensions of the religious life, the turning of religion into an instrument for what he believed a superstitious instrument for profit. And here he is, you know, you go to his grave in Tiberias, right? Or it's people don't care about whether he said that or not, right? I saw in Cordova, where I visited, where there is the statue of Maimonides, something Maimonides will really not like. People kiss the people. I mean, I'm talking about tourists, not particularly great Maimonidean scholars, who come and kiss his feet.
So you've been there.
I've been there, but I didn't do one thing. I didn't kiss
his feet.
And it's they tell me that it's a good amulet for wisdom. Right? Can you imagine what Maimonides will think about that? Right?
So that's a good segue to question I've really been wanting to ask you, which is you describe this transformational figure with this tremendous ambition, but you're giving some humorous examples about where his overall project didn't work,
right?
Where it was not received in the way in which he would have liked it to have been received. And that could be a kind of stand-in for a more serious question about to what extent his most ambitious projects, which you don't want to call them rationalist, fair enough, but the reason-driven project, to what extent is that in his, you know, seen from the distance of 800 years, a successful or an unsuccessful project in the Jewish legal tradition?
I'll tell you, it's a complex story. One aspect, I would call, you know, I was very influenced by a historian of philosophy by the name of Pierre Hadot, who wrote about this tradition of philosophy as a spiritual exercise. Right. It's a long tradition, Socratic. Spinoza was the last of the who thought that really philosophy is about redemption of the soul. The ethics end with kind of this redeeming quality of love of God. He was a Maimonidean. Now, Maimonides didn't succeed in that feature of his understanding of the role of wisdom and philosophy and the religious life in totality. That's clear. Because for the masses, he would call the masses, right? The function of religion is, first of all, secure life, income, children, etc. If he doesn't do that, who needs it, right? And to overcome that, it's very hard. So he failed in that. I mean, failed in that massively, monumentally failed, a monumental failure. He did succeed in uprooting anthropomorphism in a literal sense. He did succeed in that. He didn't succeed in the work of codification, right? He wanted to stabilize the organism called Talmud by the last word. And there is a very fascinating remark by one of the greatest rabbinic figures of the 16th century who described the project of codification in the following shrewd way. He said, in Jewish law, every attempt of anybody to codify the tradition, so to stabilize this immense growth of legal discussion, works works the opposite from the intentions of the codifiers. What they do is just they don't extinguish this fire, they add oil. Because now you have to interpret Maimonides, right? Can you, now there is just another more material. So his codification work was a colossal failure. Because he thought he will stop the immense explosion of this organism by this great literary act, which ended up just adding more material for Talmudists to
do the kind of stuff he doesn't want you to spend your time doing.
Exactly. Yeah. So what was it? But yet, I mean, a lot of legal formulations, a lot of his understanding of law survived. And what mainly survives is an alternative voice that didn't, that is not dominant, but is there, and nobody can completely marginalize it. It's just there. It's an option that then inspired.
You just have to reinterpret it in such a way as to.
Right, but it's,
you can't marginalize it, but you can marginalize its content.
Yeah, it's there. It's there. It's a brave attempt that didn't succeed in transforming the tradition, but succeeded in adding to it a rare, powerful voice. That's what I would say.
May I ask you a biographical question? And then soon I want to open it up to the audience. But the sentence that you mentioned a few moments ago, it made it a big impression on me when I read it in the book, where you said that if one is reading this later code of Jewish law, the Shulchan Aruch, the set table, which is the most effective code, which comes 300 odd years after Maimonides and becomes later the kind of basic structural text for contemporary Orthodox Judaism, that when you're reading that, you can sort of you can see Maimonides' words bouncing off the page, leaping out at you, even if you didn't know they were from Maimonides.
Right.
And I thought, what an interesting autobiographical statement on your part, because it suggests a person who first encountered at least some of these texts in the way that they are reused in later normative texts. I mean, I'm very sympathetic to this. I don't think I really ever heard of Aristotle until I saw him in Moses Maimonides.
Right.
And that seemed like a good reason to study him. And then, what do you know, he had some independent existence.
Maimonides gave a very strong recommendation on Aristotle.
He does,
right? He said this is the wisest man who reached the highest degree of human perfection before prophecy.
Yeah, so, but it shows you something that one could think that was a good reason to go and read Aristotle. But in any event, what I'm wondering is whether your experience in being trained in Jewish law in the traditional manner before addressing these issues philosophically, structurally, conceptually, from the standpoint of let's call it broadly contemporary academic legal theory, how you think that's affected your perception of Maimonides and how you think it affected the construction of the book?
I grew up in the world of the yeshiva. To answer, or as they say, a shvere Rambam, a difficult Maimonides, where you have a contradiction, was the highest achievement of a scholar, right? And I remember.
Just to clarify what that means, what it means is that Maimonides makes these declarations, and then you go back and you look at the earlier sources on which he's drawing,
and you
can't figure out why in the world he says this.
Right,
even
and also.
Even in his lifetime.
Yeah.
So then the question is,
and also there are contradictions in the text itself. I remember, I even recall a mythic story, not mythic actually, a real story about a great rabbi, great scholar, great Talmudic scholar who answered a contradiction in Maimonides. Then they showed him that Maimonides himself was asked about that. And he has a completely different answer in the letter. And the rabbi looked at it and said, and that's an answer? So you had this, and that taught me one thing. It taught me that's a text that deserves that. A very close reading on the one hand, and the other thing is, you know that he's a conceptual thinker. You know that if there is a formulation there, it's driven by a legal conceptual frame. It's not an ad hoc solution to a textual problem. That's not the way he works. So I think I grew up in an atmosphere where Maimonides was taken both seriously in close reading and also as a wellspring of conceptual thinking, legally. Then I realized, afterwards, I realized that there are few books of Maimonides they never let me read, right? So I became definite. Maimonides even recommended his own books. So then an expansion began in terms of locating all that within. But that early training, which is actually, I think, is good training in law altogether, never left me, and I always come back to this very fine works. For example, his understanding of the role of intention in prayer, right? It's some very beautiful, complex statements. were and then there was a great tradition of scholarship in the yeshivot trying to understand the role of intention, where you see how it transforms the tradition. For him, intention is not a condition of fulfilling the verbal act of prayer. It constitutes the act of prayer, right? Therefore, a prayer without intention is not a mistaken prayer, a flawed action. It's not a prayer altogether. Now, if you go about that, if you go this way, you're going to have to do a lot of reinterpreting different materials in the Talmud that worked on the questions of intention, right? There is a beautiful statement in the Talmud, in the Jerusalem Talmud about intention, when rabbis begin to confess about their failure in intending in prayer. And one of them says, I was trying to intend, and I found myself counting how many sheep do I have in my head. And then the other rabbi says, I give thanks to my spine, that there is a word in prayer where you have to bow when you come to it. I give thanks to my spine that it automatically bows when I get to that word. Right? So, if you take Maimonides' conception of the role of intention in prayer, which grows out of his theological, philosophical understanding of the meaning of the act, then he will have to then rework a lot of legal stuff in his tradition, which he is obligated to. And part of the interesting experience of reading this person is knowing, on the one hand, that he comes up with a radically innovative conception of the role of intention, and then to see how interpretively he will reorganize all the past material to fit that scheme. This is good legal work. This is what we think about an advancement in law. So, all this aspect of my youth learning of Maimonides, I think as a young person, I could recite quite a lot of Maimonides' law code. So there is that aspect that stayed all along, yeah, biographically speaking.
Questions?
Yes.
Dick.
So can you comment on the connection or lack of between this project that you've been talking about and the fact that Maimonides grew up in a society with three religious,
right,
and was a physician, and
right,
a physician, moreover, to Arab rulers.
Right. Well, that's an important point. Maimonides was born in Andalusia, right, in Cordova, at the height of the kind of Islamic Jewish renaissance and coexistence. But at a very young age, all that fell apart. There was a radical Islamic movement coming from North Africa into Spain that basically decimated all that reality. And he became a refugee. The family left Spain and went into the North Africa, then ended up in Egypt.
And you should just add that one of his biographers thinks it's highly probable that the family were forcibly converted to Islam,
right,
during that period of time.
Right, right. And by the way, Maimonides, one of his youth letters, very fascinating responsa, was how do you relate to all those Jews in North Africa who were forced to convert to Islam against another rabbi who claimed that they are now, have declared themselves outside the tradition, etc., etc. And he tries to include them in a very complicated legal analysis. Now, in his mentality, he's a refugee and an immigrant. I would say an immigrant into an environment that is a shadow of his past home, whom he disregards. He came to, like a great immigrant who comes to a very small town, and he has no interlocutors. And if he's around many pretenders who think they know something, but if they would have been in Andalusia, nobody even would have talked to them. In his own, and he always will say, even 30, 40 years life, he will call himself a Sfaradi, the Spaniard, the one from Andalus, though he's already in Cairo for 40 years or so. Now, part of the way in which such people survive is through the medical occupation, because rulers would not trust a local physician from the same religious ethnic groups. They need someone who's good and doesn't have any power base in the society, because you don't want to be with a physician whom you think is poisoning you. So I think a lot of his life, philosophical and legal life, is to try to recapture the lost homeland, philosophically as well, where Al-Farabi and Averroes was, you know, could be studied in an integrated fashion. By the way, I think, at least in Jewish codification, all great codes are written by immigrants, because there is a connection between codification and crisis. They feel there is a lost world that they have to recapture in their work, codify. So I think as a person, it's an immigrant from a great homeland that he tries to reincarnate through writing. Then struggling, he, by the way, was a very savvy person. I mean, we know that many great minds have no human understanding of their environment. That wasn't the case with him. He actually was very shrewd, I would say, even in reading his environment and managing it. So that was part of that past. Yes. Yes.
So you mentioned the case of Spinoza, and I was wondering what you thought is the most telling or decisive difference between the amor intellectus Dei and Spinoza, and the conception of love as wisdom in Maimonides that you referred to. Right. And I just have also one comment about the idea that Spinoza was the last philosopher to understand philosophy as spiritual redemption. It occurred to me that perhaps this was something that Nietzsche tried to do, but on an atheistic foundation.
And then Wittgenstein in some other ways, yeah. So I think there is a lot of philosophical closeness between Spinoza and Maimonides, but I think the main difference comes with the following idea. Spinoza wanted to divorce religion from problems of truth and to divorce politics from truth. I mean, all of the political theological tractate is to say the political world has nothing to do with the distinction between truth and false, because he understood that ensuring political freedom of thought means separating politics from truth questions. Politics is about social order, and if it guarantees that, that's fine. It's not about constituting truth. Now, Maimonides, who was no liberal or no pluralistic, thought that Torah as a law, is about promoting true idea of God and putting at the center of the legal order the achievement of truth. In that respect, they were rivals, right? And this is why when you read the Spinoza's work, he owes so much to Maimonides, right? In so many ways. But when it comes to the political vision, he's the arch enemy. And therefore Spinoza will say the prophets were not philosophers. They had no idea of truth, because religion is not about truth. So that distinction between politics and truth, religion and truth, in order for Spinoza to safeguard an open, free society, was the breaking point between those two figures.
Do you think that's why, I'm supposed to let other people ask questions, but I can't help myself. Do you think that's why in the book you don't spend as much time on Maimonides' political theory? Because of its
yeah.
distinctive illiberalism?
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. Maimonides is a very complex figure. He was open-minded on the one hand and very authoritarian on the other hand. This is why people like Strauss are very drawn to that mentality, right? So you have a sense that radical open-mindedness and deep conservatism that had to do with handling what he would call the masses, right? His relationship to the masses is so complex, right? Because he worked for them and with them and he detested them. And for him, the masses means people that are controlled by the imaginative faculty. What it is to be controlled by the imaginative faculty? It's being controlled by threats and promises, which is the way politicians control crowds, by threats and promises. You see, though we are post-mass society, when you see political advertisements, you understand Maimonides, right? Everybody is threatening that the other will bring the end, and he's promising, and people buy into it. Now, a philosopher, unlike the masses, knows one very important thing, to distinguish between what's possible and what's impossible. That's the kernel of what distinguishes the elite from the masses. And his politics in that respect is deeply authoritarian. And it's a very complex combination between philosophical open-mindedness and conservative authoritarianism when it comes to, I think in the history of halakha, maybe the most authoritarian of all halachic thinkers. Because of this kind of combination of truth and politics, a truth and halakha as a theme. Yeah.
Time for maybe one last question. Eric.
Yeah, Moshe, maybe the invocation of Pierre Hadot invites me to think about Maimonides' relation to this third mystical tradition.
Sure.
Because the other analogy, of course, is someone like Aquinas, sure. where in Beatitude, it seems for Aquinas, reason gives way to some form
right.
of, there's no friction. You don't have to kind of have a debate.
Right.
But when I read, maybe not Maimonides, but scholars Maimonides, the vision of perfection looks like a law seminar and sort of continued agonism of reason giving. So is that a misimpression of mine, or just generally, what is the goal of the philosophical life? If it is truth, does it give way finally to some kind of piety and contemplation rather than reason giving?
That's a great question. This is why I didn't like the rationalist stem, because it's the cold and the hot. You know, there's the cold, sober, distant, boring, reason-giving people, and then the mystical fervor. Now, two short points. First, what I said before. The role of reason is to shift you from fear to love. Maimonides keeps, the ultimate goal is the possibility of love of God and the world. And then overcoming death, confront. Maimonides says philosophy is training to die. By that he meant the capacity to confront the end without fear. Right? That's the true moment for philosophical perfection. It's not about reason-giving seminar. At the end, it's about the capacity to reconcile with the world in a mode of love. Now, but there is another thing where mysticism comes in, maybe in a genuine way. It has to do with his critique of religious language. Maimonides, one of the most radical philosophical ideas of Maimonides, this idea of negative theology. By that he meant that there is no way of formulating proposition, true and sensible propositions about God in language. For very deep reasons, right? You even cannot say God is one, because that is already a violation of the transcendence of God, etc. And then he says, in the guide he says there is one great verse in the Psalms Lecha dumiyat tuila, for you silence is praise. The ultimate goal of religious life is silence. And there is overcoming language that you have to come. Now, there is a debate. It's an interesting debate. His son, by the way, who was very influenced by Sufi, mystical Islam, Sufism, always thought that this moment of silence is purging yourself for a, you might say, a linguistic encounter with the divine, as if you purged your consciousness from the boundaries of language, and now you go mystical. But mystical not in the kind of ecstatic form, it's a mysticism in which you have been purged from all mistakes. Now that the consciousness both is empty and clean, you have this kind of ineffable experience. By the way, there is a strong reason to read him this way. There is. Or you say that there wasn't anything in that respect mystical, it's just a skeptical idea of our possibility to know anything. We can negate, but not know. By the way, a very similar double interpretation of Wittgenstein's end of the Tractatus, right, where he speaks about silence and you wonder, is it a pregnant silence or not, right? There's always question about people or yourself when you're silent. So there is that stream of mystical conception that is around, and this is why the rationalist project doesn't capture what is reason in this world, because it doesn't capture that kind of philosophical spiritual exercise that is so deep in that tradition.
Well, I make no claims to its being the form of eternal felicity, but within the narrow world of our lives as people in the university, I'm not able to imagine a greater pleasure than hearing Moshe speak about questions of intellectual and spiritual engagement. I want to thank you for that very much.